So in this episode of Simulated Reality Podcast, we have Abhilasha Purwar, CEO and co-founder of Blue Sky Analytics, you know, a startup that is fighting climate change and pollution with artificial intelligence and data. Hi, Abhilasha.
Hi, how are you doing?
So for those who don't know what Blue Sky Analytics is, you know, if you can tell.
In a simple word. So Blue Sky Analytics is building what we say is Bloomberg for environmental data. We want to give long time series, spatially, temporally, continuous data sets about basic things, you know, air, water, land, soil health, water quality to people everywhere. Just democratize that information. So right now we're working on air. We have a pan-India air quality data set. We're working on emissions. So we're working on emissions, carbon emissions, and other pollution emissions that comes from fires, farm fires, industrial emissions. But yes, soon we'll be expanding into water and into climate risk. So we're very excited about that.
Yeah, what is it happening? Like in North, we have seen like, you know, pollution increasing very drastically over the last 5 years, especially in the NCR region.
Yeah.
So, you know, what do you think is the sudden reason that it's...
I think NCR just gets the news. Air pollution has been bad and has been rising for almost 10 years. It has gotten significantly worse because 5 years ago or something, the government of Punjab changed some regulations around crop fires to save water. And then that accelerated the amount of crops that we were burning, decreasing the window of harvest time. And, you know, effectively we burned 35 to 50 million tons of crop waste. And then that's a recipe for really bad air. But NCR just speaks in news. Entire North India has an air pollution problem.
Hmm.
Yeah.
And your startup, Blue Sky Analytics, you know, it's using geospatial data. And then you were doing analytics on top of it. Mm-hmm. What was the original plan? Did you think that, you know, you wanted to like fight the, you know, pollution? What was the original plan and how has it come?
So the original, very, very few founders, I think, have a plan. And it's also very ever evolving because you constantly learn from the market and constantly learn from what's happening around. In 2018, we had me and my co-founder who was working in Bangalore, mm-hmm. and I was in the US. We just had this wish to do something around climate change. Like, let's try or attempt. And then in 2018 actually, we started figuring out satellite data sets. And we're like, oh my God, dude, have you looked at the satellite? Have you looked at that satellite? Did you know you could get this information? And we just started getting so much rich data sets that we could like do so much analytics on. And it was a very interesting engineering problem statement, right? So we hadn't used that much brain in many years of our lives. Like, whoa, it's very complex. It's raw and heavy data. Mm-hmm. You have to process it. You have to build a machinery around it. You have to think of so many from so many lenses, and yeah, we just got hooked on to satellites.
Yeah, so what data sets are you then looking at? You know, the raw bunch of data out there.
Yeah, so the thing, one of the other parallel things that has happened, so one is the climate change is an accelerating problem. It's a, you know, huge crisis globally. But on the technology side, so many satellites are going upstream. So the cost of sending a satellite has gone down. You can make your own satellite, put your own sensors, you know, have some, there's an Uber for launching satellites, place it accordingly. So there's so much data coming, what I call downstream. And I felt that there wasn't enough like analytical power in the middle. And that was like a really nice space to be in. Then coming from the Indian standpoint, right, we don't always excel in hardware stuff. So we are not really in the space tech market. We don't have a huge presence on upstream. But I felt like, you know, we had such great engineering talent, such great data scientists, so many, like almost one of the highest concentration of computer science graduates. And that energy and that talent is like wasted on, you know, doing like mascara analytics, I call it, like, you know, shoes, number of shoes to sell and so on and so forth. So it was right human capital to put to work on a very interesting data set.
Yeah. So you said the Bloomberg of environmental science, right? So do you think that currently people are ignoring these data because there could be something really valuable there? But I mean, everyone is focused on business data and data analytics on business data. But do you think this could be something that, you know, we have been ignoring?
I think so 4 or 5 years ago, there were very limited ways to get to this kind of information. So there were technical challenges around like accessing information also. You simply did not have some satellites in the orbit, which provide you maximum amount of coverage or data. And this is an industry which is heavily dependent on public investment. So without ESA and NASA putting, like, ESA is European Space Agency, putting billions of dollars into upstream, we wouldn't get information. But yeah, like, I think climate change and environmental awareness in Indian context is fairly low. We do make a bet on the fact that it'll rise. Globally, it's rising, and we envision ourselves as a global play. So I think, in 2022, 23, we'll be in a good space.
Yeah, and, we've had, like, pollution control boards all over India. What have they been not doing for all those years? Like, you know, what do you think that is lagging in those?
I've worked with some pollution control boards. So in my previous to, like, you know, I worked for Ministry of Environment, and I worked with Jairam Ramesh, who was minister at that time, and with 3-4 different pollution control boards. See, PCBs were designed almost like a police structure.
Okay.
Right, their main job is regulation. And a lot of PCBs were set up in like 60s and 70s. Most of the human capital, like most of the people who you would see are the decision maker, are typically like 50-year-old men who are not always so well-versed with data and technology. Like, imagine your dad trying to like play with like APIs. It doesn't work, right? So my dad is good in what he does, but I don't think he is good in tech and data. So what is lacking with PCBs is simply the capacity or even imagination. Sometimes when you are so technologically behind, you can't even imagine what technology can does. And that's why you will always find like PCBs asking for solutions, which used to be solutions in 1980s. So how we see Blue Sky Analytics is almost like bringing the environmental monitoring system back in 2020. It's like, hey guys, would you like these fancy data sets? And like, you know, how about now you do your monitoring and your regulation on top of it?
Yeah. Also, walk us through, you know, the technology stack, because our audience is always hungry to know the nitty-gritties of the technology, not just from the above. So walk us through what the technology stack is like. How are you working with, you know, the raw data, and then you convert them into valuable data assets?
So very parallel to almost like oil refinery, you know, we say that.
But then that's like...
Yeah, like that's the best parallel, right? We say like, you know, Mukesh Ambani and Dhirubhai Ambani made like so much money on making one of the largest oil refineries in the world, right? So we're building one of the largest data refineries. That's what we call the whole machinery. You input like raw and crude data at one end, and you go through a whole bunch of like pipelines and filtering process and, you know, a whole bunch of modeling, and then you get clean data sets at the other end. The stack that we have, we primarily work with JavaScript and Python. And we work a lot with AWS infrastructure as sort of a cloud computing partner. And like add these three things and a good bunch of like data scientists and engineer. Mm-hmm. And you've got like, you know, a good machinery to process large volumes of data and give insightful, like actionable insights out of that.
Yeah. And what about the IoT part of it? Is there like you...
IoT, we don't do any data generation, like either on the IoT side or on the satellite data side. We are basically like an analytics play, but we partner with a whole bunch of people to get ground reality data. Like if there is any IoT data set out there which is pertaining to us, then we are consuming it.
And which is available, I guess.
Yeah, which is available. But I think it's growing. It's a very largely growing segment.
Yeah.
You know, all sort of like soil health monitors, water quality monitors, air quality monitors have grown exponentially in past 3 years. So they help a lot of like, they form a foundation of a satellite data business because you need enough like ground calibration data set. So it's a pretty cool space. More successful they get, better for us.
Yeah. And we'll go back to the, you know, situation in Delhi. How do you think then it can be solved? What is your vision on it that, you know, eventually...
On Delhi.
Huh?
On Delhi air pollution.
Yeah, yeah.
So I've been in this thing for quite some years, and especially past 2 years very actively. One problem happens is that there is relatively less focus. So for 2020, we started saying that, hey, let's focus on crops and crackers. It also has a nice sound to it.
Yeah.
And if it indeed becomes like Diwali and Parali. So let's just focus on these two, because often people are like construction dust. It's like, bro, our air quality is not 200 that we're talking about construction dust. We are in thousands, right? So if you want to come down from thousands to 200, let's focus on the major polluter, like elephant in the room. So yeah, as I mentioned, Punjab simply burns so much of crop waste, and Haryana burns like almost like 30 million tons of crop waste. Not just Delhi, that plume and that whole like sort of cloud of smog actually goes all the way to Bay of Bengal. So West Bengal and Orissa at times, like Calcutta, breeds the pollution that originates in Punjab. Right, so you have to think of it as a large air shed problem and have a cross multi-state collaboration to actually tackle it.
Yeah. A lot of experts, I mean, not a lot, but yeah, some experts say that, you know, that if you just let it happen, because India is in, you know, in a developing stage, and probably that's why we have not been focusing on environmental, you know, controlling environmental pollution or even global warming for that matter. Do you think that India should be focusing more on it, or it should be rather than, you know, focusing on just building up the economy, you know, and then this problem will sort itself out?
If you would have said this to me probably like 10 years ago, I would have been like, yeah, I think, you know, we are a poor country. Even, you know, personally, I did not grasp how big climate change was till about like 3-4 years ago. For India, climate change is an existential problem, and we are so unaware about it. Sometimes it feels like ironical when people are like, oh, you know, returns and families. And like, I don't think we'll have a planet to grow up to become 50-year-old. Like, that is how bad it is. Our understanding of how bad it is very, very poor. And India needs to not just like focus on it, build that understanding that it is partially apocalyptic. It is going to get very bad. Not in just in terms of air, but let's say water. You know, I mean, what will happen when Bangalore runs out of water?
Are those two things linked? Like, as much as we know, the water crisis and the global warming phenomenon, are they linked?
So there are three layers to it. One is environmental crisis, which is just not taking care of your basic environmental assets. The second one is global warming, which is sort of combination of high carbon emissions, which is leading to like just temperature increment throughout the world. And the last one is climate change, which is half the things we don't even know, like the accelerated forest fires that we see globally, accelerated typhoons, hurricanes, it's climate change. Often we take these three things and just mix them together. They are interlinked and they are separate. Environmental crisis is much more local. So for instance, the US has beautiful forests, clean water, clean air, everything. So it does not have an environmental crisis, but it does have a climate crisis. While India, or let's say in our case, Bangalore, has a severe environmental crisis. The lakes are dead or super polluted. The water table has gone for a toss. The infrastructure has gone for a toss. So, you know, even like the tree cover is diminishing marginally. The temperature is increasing. So you have a lot of things at play in this case.
The government is worried about why are not many cars being sold, right?
See, why are not many cars being sold is an economic indicator, and your economic growth is good. What we do need to worry about fact is that, yes, we are going to see a huge economic, like, for people of our age, your age and my age, this is going to be the first time in our lifetime, like, you know, us existing, that our economy will be at this growth rate. I remember graduating college and our economy was like booming and like 8%, right? My first salary was in higher than my dad's salary at that moment. And that was a product of economic liberalization plus like booming economy. What is going to happen to the 22-year-old kids now? Are there going to be enough jobs for them? So those are some of the important things. But a major focus is we have an imaginative handicap of thinking about sustainable development. We think that economic development and solving, like, you know, environmental problems is not possible together. What I say is that you will be able to yield multi-billion dollar economic output with sustainable development. Like, just think of it as a problem statement, and you've got to crack that problem statement, right? We have built large companies, large unicorns by solving problems. So if you think from the lens of problem solving and rather a social or environmental or whatever, it's like, wait, this is a problem, I got to solve it out. And you will see that there's a lot of economic potential in that game as well.
Sure. And if you look at the, you know, global geopolitical scenario, global warming is also a big thing. And then, you know, Trump getting out of the Paris Agreement and all of that. Yeah. How is that impacting, you know, at the very grassroots level, at your startup, you know, what is the impact of all those things?
I think... this is something that when I was in grad school, one of our professors actually made us do a mental exercise. That when global warming or climate change actually becomes a real threat, humanity would have two ways to go about it. One would be a more empathetic way in which we actually care about each other, and which would lead to more liberal politics. So you have the likes of it in Finland and you have in New Zealand, which is also like female-led, politics, which is very liberal and environmental. The other will be more self-centered, like let's save our group, you know, which you have in India, which is like almost like, you know, sort of in ways like we got to protect our own because climate change is coming, natural resources are shrinking. So it's a little protectionist behavior, which is both the US and some ways even Australia right now. But I think Australia will change significantly. India, a lot of other countries. The second one will not work because planet is one and it's super linked. That's something that these political folks who I think are just living in some different decade and different reality do not grasp. The world is highly interlinked. So global markets are highly interlinked. Global economies are highly interlinked. Yes. So if there is a severe crisis, Australian fires, they are going to impact global economy, including India. Right? So you will not be able to go down that route. But yes, there is a rise of fascism globally. I hope that some people will be able to save us from that.
Yeah, but then there are people who say that, you know, global warming is just, you know, it's a phenomenon that occurs every 1,000, 2,000 years, whatever, like geological age of the Earth. So do you agree with that in any form? Or is it just the humans which are causing it through carbon emissions? Like, I mean, it is the scientific consensus, but what would you say to those people, you know?
I think, I can't even begin to answer that question whether, like, you know, global warming is whatever phenomenon, it is not. You can look at all these data, or the data of ice ages. Yes. I mean, Antarctica day before yesterday was 18.5 degrees Celsius.
Yeah,
that doesn't happen for Antarctica, right? We have already crossed 1.3 degrees Celsius of warming, and right now we're on a path of 5 to 7 degrees Celsius of warming, which would leave humanity with like no place to essentially live. So the people who say that global warming is not like real or it's a natural phenomena. There is a fantastic documentary, and recently in the US Parliament, US Congress, there was a case against ExxonMobil, which knew since 70s what they were doing and were just like hiding it. So I think it's a nice PR strategy, and they have some very brilliant but absolutely immoral people who are building that narrative. It's just a narrative. You know, in Delhi we had a lot of crackers that were burned this year because a great marketing strategy was green crackers. So green crackers cause less pollution and are good for environment. So, we do have a tendency to buy into nice narratives.
But then how does a human civilization separate the politics and the environmental part? Because, you know,
these are all interlinked. Economics, politics, environment, everything is interlinked. So thinking about things in silos doesn't work. When you have a problem, you got to solve it. And thinking as broad and as broad allows you to be very innovative. I think what will happen is change in narrative and change in trends. Like people like you and I will no longer care about materialism in general. Our value systems will change, and that will lead to just much larger change.
But then isn't the opposite happening right now? I think the TikTok culture, people are more attention seeking, people are running after money because it's capitalism.
It is changing in small circles, and I think it will change in much bigger ways in the next 5 years. The next generation is expected to be much less consumeristic than the last generation. The boomers were more of like, you know, holders, like they want house, they want car, and so on and so forth. While our generation has already gotten into renta infrastructure method,
sharing economy,
like a sharing economy. So it's going to be a big change. And also, see, I think entrepreneurs and very few people drive that change. So why we are sitting here with Blue Sky Analytics, and you know, is because we want to drive the overall, you know, sort of not culture, but overall narrative in a certain direction. Yeah.
Okay, so now if you look at China, for example, you know, China also has a big pollution problem, but they are on top of innovation as well.
Yeah.
So what, again, I mean, it's a two-part question. What has been like the response from the Indian government towards you? I mean, if you have been engaging with the government, as you said, you talk with pollution boards.
Yeah.
And so what is the role of government here is what I'm trying to ask.
Government has a lot of role to play, and they have marked fair amount of like budgets for it. What happens in the Indian bureaucratic system versus the Chinese bureaucratic system is actually efficiency.
Okay.
They have very nice like efficient system in place. So when they want to shut down certain power plants or certain segments of things which are polluting, they're able to do it very quickly. On the monitoring side also, they're very, very far ahead of us. Just their monitoring networks, the algorithms, the organizational capacities is pretty awesome. So India has a little catching up to do, and that is where the role of startups is, because governments cannot always build capacity so quickly. either on the tech side or on organizational side, while a startup can do it. So probably like finding ways to work closely, and we do work closely with multiple governments and multiple agencies. It is a little drainer on a startup because governments move super slow. But yeah, like we hope to like, you know, work closely with them and solve air pollution in North.
So if you look at the ecosystem, you know, that, yeah, that's part of this environmental, you can say environmental thing. What are the entities that are part of it? I mean, government is one, citizens are one, right? And then you fit in with your startup. So how does it all connect to actually create impact?
So I think it's fundamentally thinking about imagination. Like you have to imagine a society which is carbon neutral or carbon negative, which is environmentally positive. And I use a simple word, which is like climate positive. You have to think about systems which are climate positive. And that's where society and innovation and governments come together. So let's say I create like, you know, data sets, I create Blue Sky Analytics, and it's giving you information about, imagine you go to buy a t-shirt from H&M. You get a MRP at the end of it, right? You get taxes and all, which is like government regulation. What if you got carbon, you know, how much carbon was this t-shirt, carbon footprint of that t-shirt, and water footprint of that t-shirt in your bill? Is it going to start changing your like behavior and changing your sort of habits of purchase?
Yeah.
Now, what if the government sort of, you know, gave higher mandates to like carbon neutral things or so on and so forth? So there is a place where consumption and policies change. There's a very nice quote, which is every dollar you spend is like a vote you cast. So you shape the world by actually your purchasing decisions. So at this moment, I have much more faith in just global free market.
Yeah.
I think you can structure markets in a way.
I mean, so my point earlier, the global free market is not caring about environment at the end.
It does. It is. Yeah. BlackRock just came up with, like Larry Fink, who heads BlackRock, has just said that climate strategy is now going to be the center of BlackRock's investment strategy and not like a... So in terms of how it affects my business is BlackRock manages $8 trillion worth of capital globally, right? Till today, like a few billions. I mean, now they're going to add $630 billion worth of capital into like ESG portfolio. Imagine if my data set is something which is like forming a base of like those decisions, right? So like I've got like a big pie to go there, right?
Yeah, you'll be rich then.
Just that, but like, you know, when you make an investment decision, and I saw this happen in the US coal industry in past five years, right? If you have a coal mine in the US and you are doing great revenue and you have great profits, nobody wants to touch you. Nobody wants to put any money into you. You have like, you can't have an investment to even like get working capital around. Instead, if you are an electric car company and you're not even shipping electric cars into the market, you have a valuation which is higher than Ford, right? Why is it? Because the market is actually caring about these things. So this notion is wrong.
Okay.
But there is a huge capacity dearth. We haven't built enough organizations where that money could go. There's a very high demand for climate positive startups, but the supply is really low.
So do you envision a global exchange ecosystem based on carbon credits where people...
No, I just think the share market.
Just sharing.
I think
economy.
The share market. No, the share markets. Okay. Like, you know, I mean...
the stocks.
I think at one point, oil stocks would like...
So what I was saying is that the carbon credits could actually be a commodity in future, possibly.
See, they've tried carbon credits, and I hope carbon credits come back and it would be great, but it did not work out like 5 to 10 years ago. I think carbon, when mixed with the share market, because setting up a whole new market and its whole regulation and like everything is like a whole pain in itself.
Crypto market is in that stage right now.
I mean, market is also like...
So, I mean, it's in that nascent stage where they're figuring out, and a lot of startups have actually put it on.
What has happened in...
Like tokenized form of carbon credits, right?
What is happening in terms of carbon or climate change and global market is that global capital market is now taking climate change as a central to its strategy. So like bonds and equity and derivatives, which are forming. So I think in future, people will make investment decisions, not just based on returns, but also on economic, on environmental.
So China would then accumulate all the carbon credits, just like they have accumulated all the US treasury bonds, and they'll say, I will just pollute environment because we have carbon credits.
No, that's why I'm saying. I'm not talking about carbon credit market.
Okay.
I'm talking about just global capital market.
Okay, so terms of applications and gadgets probably?
No, what I'm saying is that if you have a share, if you are a company, if you're a multi-billion dollar company, I'm saying in future, people will not buy your stock if you're a carbon emitting company.
Okay.
Simple as that. I will give data to people of which company has what carbon footprint. And the companies which have highest carbon footprint, even if their revenues and their profits are insane, nobody will hold them. You can make as much, you know, like imagine you're a company. What is your value? Your value is the cost of your share, right? Let's talk case of WeWork, which went for an IPO recently last year, right? The capital market was not buying the share. They were like, but SoftBank is invested in us.
Yeah, because it was overvalued. They had valued it.
The value is done by us. We do the valuations.
Yeah.
Like Tesla is extremely overvalued. Like if you look at their revenue, profit, it is a super hyper-valued company, but it is out in the global market. And it is, I don't know what the share is, like 370 or something right now. So it is on, people like you and I, like an average equity investor, an average retail investor makes these decisions. And there is a huge sort of pull out from the carbon stocks, I think.
Okay.
Yeah.
And by pull out, you mean...
Like Aramco's IPO would have been 10 times more successful five years ago. Right?
Okay, I got your perspective. So companies are actually looking at it more seriously as a part of their future
strategy.
I'm
saying those companies won't exist.
Oh.
Nobody will buy Shell stocks 10 years from today. Doesn't matter what profit Shell does.
Okay, got it.
Okay. It's like you are almost like, a lot of these carbon intensive or environmentally polluting companies are going to go into this like untouchable category where I don't care, but I don't want to be associated with you because I don't think you're good.
Okay.
Okay,
so what is then your business strategy here? Right?
Our business strategy is actually to provide data to all of this.
Okay.
We're going to put numbers behind everything, and then next time you buy your t-shirt, we'll tell you what your carbon footprint was and what your water footprint was. And then you'll be like, wait, this t-shirt is $300 and this t-shirt is $3,000, but I'm going to buy the one which is $3,000 or I'm not going to buy any of them because damn, this girl is telling me my carbon footprint. So that is our strategy. And that is our strategy for all the, like a lot of stocks in the world. You know, I think, for instance, like a lot of big oil companies, they just get away with what they're doing because we don't put numbers to it. We know that there's a lot of carbon emissions, or mining companies, right? We don't put numbers to it. What if somebody started to put numbers to it?
Hmm.
Would your decisions start to change, you know? And that's our whole plan for the next decade.
Yeah. And if you could just, you know, touch upon some of your other clients and, you know, the different verticals.
We're a very early stage company. So, you know, we're just starting to like get off. We're practically an 8-month-old company, essentially, right? So we are looking in the healthcare space. We are looking into insurance space. We are looking at financial institutions.
Yeah.
And we'll be building our presence with them.
Yeah.
And see how it goes.
But walk us through, like, what kind of value can these data sets, can Blue Sky Analytics create for, let's say, insurance or healthcare? If you can give, you know, some examples.
So, for instance, let's talk about risk of a particular portfolio. So, you're a big insurance company and you have underwritten a lot of assets in Bangalore, right? And now I come and tell you that, hey, I mean, every other big company, right, like all of HSRs, like Udan and everybody, they have bought insurance products for their business, you know. And I come and tell you, hey, in 2022, Bangalore's going to run out of water. Right, now tell me the impact on insurances.
Mm-hmm.
This is a business interruption insurance that a generally large business buys, right? Now, Udan is not in business for a month because there's no water and employees can't come to office. Who is paying the brunt of it? The insurance guy is paying brunt of it. So would the insurance guy want to get that information from me in advance to know when Bangalore is going to run out of water? Right. So this is the value add to insurance. And it's a large market globally. It's not just like an Indian market. Everything from typhoons, hurricanes, forest fires, just high temperature days. You know, one of the big risks that I call is extreme heat days. So take the entire state of Uttar Pradesh or Rajasthan. The days when the temperature will go above 50 degrees Celsius. There will be no economic activity in those days, and there'll be a really high healthcare cost because a lot of people will get like, you know, sick, will probably even die. A lot of people will go to hospitals. So now can I provide information to hospitals, one, or healthcare system to be able to tackle that better? And can I also provide information to the, you know, just imagine the economic impact of these extreme heat days, right? Like Middle East. You're looking at it as a large, like, sort of client base because Middle East will have many, many days of 52, 53 degrees Celsius in the next decade. which means a lot for whether people can even do business meetings or not, right? So this is the sort of the play that we are in.
Sure. And do you think that India's, you know, growing space strategy and, you know, the drones coming up, do all of this data that will be generated with this, you know, will help you?
Yeah, like, I mean, I think the data generation thing is, yeah, there is explosion happening. I'm really excited about that. So my raw material is getting like cheaper by the day, right? I would love for ISRO and IMD and just like government agencies to make like adopt a little more open data platform policies. Mm. Even today, we're mostly reliant on European Space Agency and NASA for our data sets,
okay,
and not the Indian satellites, simply because the transactional cost of acquiring data set is high. The cost is really low, but writing an email, mailing, calling, that's just, so just like release those APIs, we'll do our thing. Just don't like put them behind like walls and like clicks and buttons.
I mean, with this APIs and, you know, and data analytics, data science on the environmental data, there must be like other startups also working. So how can you then collaborate with those other startups, maybe perhaps not in India, maybe then many in India? You know, how can you create this ecosystem, even with large companies, to create these products which are environmental friendly and then obviously in the long run save the civilization? Yeah,
that's a nice word. Nice thing to it. So we do think, so one of the focus points that we have is obviously climate change, and the second one is geospatial data. But on the third, we actually care a lot about open source and developer ecosystem. So most of our API, the idea is that we provide you data set and then you play with it.
Yeah.
Like, you know, we want to give data sets to like students in like colleges and have them like build whatever they want to build on top of it. So in future, in the next 2-3 years, you will hear about us more in the dev ecosystem. So my tech team and our CTO is, so my CTO is a college dropout. He literally like left college after first year of engineering and was like, okay, I'm off to Bangalore, the Silicon Valley of India, and I'll figure out something. Yeah. And I think, the new generation, thanks to democratization of information via internet, we can learn whatever we want to at the clicks of a finger. So if you want a degree in philosophy or psychology, you can have it 1 week later.
I mean, so it's anyway, the education, I think, is already, like, all the information is already out there. So, I mean, a degree is probably, like, just a confirmation.
It's a namesake.
Yeah.
Like, in our shop, we don't care about whether you have a degree or not. Just like you have to, like, I think we have three major focuses, which is you need to have a resolve, you need to be really curious, and you got to care about something and hopefully care about planet, right? But yeah, the idea is in future we provide this data set to whole bunch of developers and whole bunch of students.
Yeah, have hackathons, you know,
exactly.
Can solve a bunch of problems that way. Yeah,
that'll be pretty.
Yeah, we also do like some hackathons here at Analytics India magazine, so on different problems.
Yeah,
and we have those data sets which people work on. So what are the challenges? You mentioned that the, you know, acquiring data could be a challenge in India. What other infrastructure problems are there?
So I think once you are at a problem and you are at it for a certain amount of time with the right strategy, you're able to solve it. So we've solved for many of them. When we started, we felt that people didn't care. We met a lot of investors and a lot of like angels who were like, oh, air pollution, there's no money in it. Like, people are like, you should sell your business as an AI business rather than an air pollution or climate change business. Like, change your narrative. So, you know, I think we do stick to our cause at some level. Like, we do, AI and technology is a tool for us, but we are into what we're doing because of climate change, right? But we kept on meeting people and talking to them and being like, hey, you got to care about climate change. So we've changed that narrative, and on the investment side or on the, you know, funding and so on and so forth. The next problem we have is human capital, you know, financial capital, human capital. So we do find it slightly challenging to find people in India who understand climate change very well and who understand technology well. So that nexus, if you're able to build that one, will be pretty cool. Like, you know, developers against climate change, I think that can like really rock, or data scientists against climate change. That would be another second challenge. Once you figure out these two pieces in a company, like your team, and enough capital to be able to pay your team, you know, and you have like a broader, nice North Star, you can solve everything else. So,
And it's not just about environment. I think it's going to impact like all industries, like each and every industry. So you're going to be like working with all of them, whether it's
going to impact every single human being.
Yeah.
You know, it's a matter of life and death at some level. We don't get it because we and if you do go into more like rural parts of India, actually, you will see that a lot of like economic sort of, you know, degrowth that we are observing right now. I don't know how much, a lot of it is obviously stupid policy. A lot of our 4.8% of growth is thanks to GST and demonetization. But some part is that temperature is really high. The groundwater table is going really low. So agricultural outputs are at high risk. The farmer faces the highest brunt of climate change. And a lot of agri startup are looking at it from an agri tech perspective. But once you start to look at it from a climate change perspective, you find a lot of really answers as well.
So, you know, do you think that, you know, the Australian bushfire could have been controlled if there was proper predictive modeling systems in place, if they had been, you know, such things, and if you could have some similar systems in India? I mean, probably we might not have fires on that large scale, but as you mentioned, the water table, for example, you know, all those things, you know, the agriculture, which is the backbone of our economy, right?
Agriculture is no longer backbone of our economy.
I mean, what I meant is that a large chunk of the population
of GDP comes
contribution to GDP is low, but
yeah,
the number of people who are engaged,
yeah,
in it is what I meant. So do you think that something like that could be done on a large scale?
Yeah, we need to do a very large scale. Like, we need to almost imagine a world in India in which 25 to 30% of current labor force is not in agriculture.
Okay.
And that imagination is not happening at a macro level. Mm. And frankly speaking, it scares the living hell out of me. Because I feel those people are going to be left so marginalized, right? 48% of labor force in agriculture, which is producing 18% of economic output. That is one recipe for inequality. So if you were to grow up and be 18 years old and be like, hey dad, I'm going to be a farmer, you might as well go to your father and be like, I'm going to be extremely poor for the rest of my life. So at a very macro, like government policy, very top level, we are not thinking about de-agriculturalization of our economy, which is very scary for me.
Why is it scary?
Because agriculture, like, one, the reliance is mostly on water. So we end up actually exporting water. I think India harvests, like, you know, extracts more water than, like, US every year. And we don't have that much water. Like,
yeah, but US has, like, so many fresh lakes, you know, all of that.
And also a lot of groundwater. Like, so rice export that we are very proud of, like, basmati, right? It is literally taking a whole bunch of water and being like, hey, would you like to buy it at a very subsidized price? Right? So in that sense, at a very political level, I think you told, like, you know, asked that whether we work with the government. So local governments or some governments have started to think about it. Aadmi Party just came in power today, extremely happy. They do have a little like environmental sort of bent, but the current Ministry of Environment has almost like said that air pollution doesn't kill. And I don't know how much like climate change has been on that radar. Like, in one of the speeches, Modi was like, climate change nahi hua hai, we have changed. So I don't know what's happening there. But yeah, like moving economy out of agriculture at a very large scale and imagining those things are going to be critical if we were to survive for next 50 years. Yeah.
So what is your vision then for future? Are you optimistic about global warming? Are you, you know, with technologists like yourself, you know, coming together and solving this problem?
Yeah, I think if I've seen a great change in 1 year. Like, you know, you would have asked this question in 2018 and I was super pessimistic because I was like, nobody cares, dude. But in 1 year, like, I feel people have started to care. And the most important thing is that if we do put our mind and our will to something, we can solve it. Right? So whether it's like, you know, us and a bunch of other people, like, you have solutions, you know, solar, urban farming, vertical farming, like, not, you know, not using single-use plastic, anti-consumption, changing some certain parts of lifestyle. You have a lot of solutions that are out there. You know, you have a lot of data out there. And I think you'll have some right entrepreneurs who will come. And hopefully the ecosystem will, like, you know, invest into them and have them thrive. And you'll have, like, great solutions. The world in 2030 will not look like today.
Awesome. Great.
Yeah.
Thank you so much for coming, you know, sharing your story, sharing those insights. Really appreciate it.
Yeah, thanks for having me here. This is amazing. Nice to meet you.
So,